This program is proudly brought to you by ComCopy, the duplicating specialists. Good evening and welcome to the second retro edition of In Between the Sprockets. I'm Madeline Swain. On tonight's program, we'll be talking to director Mark Huestis about his new film Sexes, and we'll also be reviewing that. We'll also be showing Kelly Simpson's short film Wax Me, and our video review is David Campbell looking at Woody Allen's film Crimes and Misdemeanors. But first up, what is sex anyway? Sex is...
Sex is exciting. Sex is bonding. Sex is an intellectual force.
You can't have it with everybody. But when it happens, sex is love.
Sex is positive.
Sex isn't the be-all and end-all. It can sometimes be bad.
Sex is one of the best things about life.
What inspired me to make Sexes? Well, it actually was a long time in coming, so to speak. The movie sort of germinated in the late 1980s, where in America we had a political climate of vast conservatism. Funny, it's gone back to that all of a sudden. But there was the Jesse Helms, Robert Mapplethorpe controversy over artistic expression and freedom. And some of us in the community were, I mean, the whole artistic response to that was, okay, this happened, but we won't do this anymore. And some of us in the community said, we're going to continue to do this kind of art. This is the type of art that is community art, and that we pay taxes, and as gay people, we should see our tax dollars going to community art. And so that was kind of like an invigorating, politicizing moment within the gay community.
Your attention, please. It is the sense of the Congress that none of the funds authorized to be appropriated for the National Endowment for the Arts may be used to promote, disseminate, or produce materials which in the judgment of the National Endowment for the Arts may be considered obscene, including, but not limited to, depictions of sadomasochism, homoeroticism, or individuals engaged in sex.
I think it's tragic that taxpayers' money is funding this kind of trash.
And which, when taken as a whole, do not have serious literary, artistic, political, or scientific value.
I've always been a very sexual person, although as I grow older, that kind of lessens, but that's another story. I found that my sexuality was a very important part of fueling my artistry. And so I thought it was very important that we really talk about what was happening within our community sexually. And so I thought, and also there was always this value judgment in our community. It was like, well, if it wasn't for the drag queens or the leather people or these damn, you know, monogamists, they're, you know, assimilating our community, and, you know, they're just like heterosexuals. And I was like, I'm tired of that. You know, it's like everybody has their place. Everybody makes their decisions. If you're in a monogamous couple, there's nothing wrong with that. Fine, good. If you decide on celibacy, that's your decision. If you're into S&M, that's what you're doing. As long as you're doing it within the confines of safe sex, there's nothing wrong with that. You know, so I just wanted to kind of have something that was sort of a sexual smorgasbord, so to speak, that kind of clearly defined all the options that were there and presented them in a non-judgmental, positive light.
There this thing about SM where when people who aren't into it, they'll see a whipping demonstration or something, and the dude doesn't have a hard-on. Well, it's not about a hard-on. It's not about a hard-on. There is a spirituality that ignores these conventions of get it up and get it off.
I'm sorry, but if I'm having sex with you and I'm enjoying it, if you reach out and smack me, you're going to get smacked back. It just doesn't work that way.
SM to me means sex magic. Now, it's not sadomasochistic, it's very magic.
I know it's romantic and I know it feels wonderful to have someone sit and tweak your nipples, but then you want to get the guys that want to find radio stations and things. It's like, God damn it, you ain't in the war. You're not going to get no curling. If you don't stop twisting my nipples that way, I'm going to hit you. It's like, tell me when you get KML and I'll be happy. You want the antenna while you're at it, honey?
But the challenge for me is getting like a straight jock in bed with me and saying, well, no, we're not going to do what you do at home with your girlfriend. We're going to do something else.
But yet, here's this man walking up and tell her, hey, baby, you look good. How big is your dick? And I'm like, makes no sense.
See, what they all say to me, and this is what the whole experience is that they go, well, I wouldn't want to do it with a guy, but I'll do it with you because you're a girl. And then, like, they're sucking you off and they reach up and they feel your tits. And, like, that's the whole thing. I mean, that's as nasty as we want to be. That's what you're doing all the time. And then you turn him over and fuck him.
I also had been diagnosed HIV positive in 1985 and probably have been positive well before that, and knew that I was continuing to have sex. And in media at that point, we were seeing things like Long Time Companion and Early Frost and everything where, you know, everybody was in these nice couples and, you know, not to denigrate that work, it was important for its time, but, you know, Long Time Companion had eight characters, four of which were in monogamous couples. And, I mean, you never know how they got the disease, you know, the way they're presented in the film. And I found that to be very frustrating. And
one of those other turning points in my life, I realized you fucked up. You know, you tried to fall in love to stop AIDS, and that's not doing it. There must be something else. You're going to have safe sex.
The safer sex movement really got going around 1985, where queer men really started saying, we have to take sexual agency again. We have to stop thinking that we're not going to have sex anymore, and we have to make sure that we stay alive and protect ourselves and our community when that's happening. And the group of people in 1984, 85 began to develop the concept of eroticizing safer sex, of presenting condoms, dental dams, water-based lubes, the various apparatus of safer sex, not as hygienic devices that, you know, smelled of alcohol and gave off the sound of squeaking nursey shoes on clean linoleum, but rather that they were sex toys.
Raising the finances for this movie was not easy. Because, conservative organizations were not going to give me money. I had a real hard time with multicultural progressive organizations because I think the fact that I was a white gay man making this film really hurt me, which, that's another issue all into itself. We went to rich gay men, you know, the David Geffens of the world who, you know, go to parties and wear red ribbons and, you know, smooths with Cher and Madonna are just fabulous. And they were like, you've got to be kidding. No thanks. Click. You know. So basically, we did a lot of small house parties where my partner, Lawrence Hellman, and I cut cheese and celery sticks and, you know, carrots. And, you know, people gave $20, $30 checks. It was very grassroots. We did a lot of benefits in clubs, theaters, that kind of thing. People got very sick of us. I mean, I got to the point where I'd walk down the street and I could see people like walking the other direction because they knew I was going to come up and either A, hit them up for money, or B, complain about not having any money. And finally, we, at the point where it was either this is going to happen or it's not, we both got on the phone, begged, borrowed, and stealed from relatives, friends, whatever, and we borrowed a lot of money to get it done.
This is Gay San Francisco. an inside look at the life of San Francisco's homosexuals. They number 90,000 at least, according to police department figures. They move in all walks of life. Except for hairdressing and a few other occupations, their presence is unknown. They work to conceal their sexual orientation by day, and only at night do they show their true colors, as they gather together in bookstores, restaurants, nightclubs, bars, and steam baths, all catering exclusively to gay San Francisco's numerous homosexuals.
The bars, yes, the bars. Oh my. One of my main memories of the bars was being in a hot underground bar with a dance floor, having wool pants on that itched, and a white starch collar kind of cutting into your neck, and dancing with a stranger who you were so intimate with. You weren't dancing away from them. You were holding them. And it was a slow dance, and you were rubbing up against them. And you were hot, and you were uncomfortable, and you had a hard-on, and it was so delicious.
The movie has been a success story. Interestingly enough, all those people that said no wanted comps to the opening night. Gee, it's funny how that happens. We were the fifth highest grossing documentary of 1993-94 in America, according to Variety. The movie is very audience friendly, and audiences can relate to it. It's not a film that's really distant and there on the screen, and you know, the audience kind of comes in and out or floats in. These are issues that everybody can relate to in one way or the other. And although the characters are presented in a non-judgmental way, you know, people say, oh, I like this person, or I don't like this person. You know, everybody brings their own life to it.
Sex is destruction and rebirth. Sex is like the phoenix that rises up again. And sex is the reason why I'm making this movie.
It's very difficult for a film to keep the audience interest when it features as many talking heads as this one does, but Sex is just about manages to pull it off, so to speak. It's very funny, it's pretty poignant, and it is also extremely educational, especially for a gay girlie like me, because I've always wondered what they got up to. I give it a 7, but I do say go and see it in the cinema because it works much, much better with a big audience. Coming up next, our video review, which is Little Spunk David Campbell looking at that other little spunk, Woody Allen, in Crimes and Misdemeanors.
Hi, I'm David Campbell, and I'm at the Universal Theatre in Melbourne at the moment doing Kid Inside, which is also touring elsewhere around the country. Just a brief plug, Kid Inside is musical theatre songs and nostalgia songs all mixed in together, given a contemporary edge by myself and Peter J. Casey in concert. Highly recommended. Another thing that's highly recommended is the film I will be reviewing for you right now, which is Crimes and Misdemeanors by Woody Allen. The first Woody Allen film I saw was at 19, and it was Annie Hall, and then I moved on to Crimes and Misdemeanors, and I think it's one of the best Woody Allen films that he's written so far.
I love New York. I was born in that building right there, behind the guy, the statue there, the guy in the pedestal. I love New York. It's like thousands of straight lines, just looking for a punchline, you know? And what makes New York such a funny place is that there's so much tension and pain and misery and craziness here. And that's the first part of comedy. But see, you got to get some distance from it. You know what I mean? That the thing to remember about comedy is if it bends, it's funny. If it breaks, it's not funny. So you got to get back from the pain. You see what I mean? But like they said, they asked me up in at Harvard. A bunch of kids asked me, what's comedy? So I said, and then this is part of what I'm trying to say about getting back from it. I said, comedy is tragedy plus time. Tragedy plus time. See, when the night Lincoln was shot, you couldn't joke about it. You couldn't make a joke about that. You just couldn't do it. Now time has gone by, and now it's fair game. See what I mean? It's tragedy plus time.
Okay, we're out.
That's it? So fast?
I shut up 10 rolls on your first question.
All right, I gotta get to CBS anyway. Remember where we were. We'll start this again tomorrow. Just remember what I was saying.
This film, Crimes and Misdemeanors, I describe as a serio comedy, which is really about the duality of human nature, which harps back to early Greek times. The Greek playwrights write about the two sides of human nature. There's the civilized, which is, you know, where we all live day to day and we all go to work and we all have our own lives. And then there's the more nature side, which is where, you know, we used to go out as cavemen and beat up dinosaurs and then rip apart, you know, lions and things. So I'm never that strong now. But what we have here is this study of duality of human nature taken to upper New York Manhattan society. So I think it's a terrific study myself.
Christ, Jack, what are you suggesting?
What did you call me for?
I don't know. I hoped you'd have more experience with something like this.
You called me because you needed some dirty work done. That's all you ever call for.
Look how bitter you are.
You've staked me plenty of times. I don't forget my obligations.
Threatening will only make it worse, Jack.
Okay, forget about it. What do you want me to say?
How the hell can I forget about it? I'm fighting for my life. This woman's going to destroy everything I've built.
That's what I'm saying, Judah. If the woman won't listen to reason, then you go on to the next step.
What, threats? Violence? What are we talking about here?
She can be gotten rid of. I mean, I know a lot of people. Money will buy whatever's necessary.
I'm not even going to comment on that. That's mind-boggling.
Well, what did you want me to do when you called me?
Not to do dirty work, despite what you think. Anyway, it's gone beyond just Miriam now. She's talking financial doings. I'm out of ideas. I don't know what I expected from you, Jack, but some help.
You know, you're not aware of what goes on in this world. I mean, you sit up here with your 4 acres.
Don't give me any
and your
of that
country
stuff.
Club.
I don't want to hear about my
and your rich friends. And out there in the real world, it's a whole different story.
Oh, come on.
I've met a lot of characters from when I had the restaurant.
I know you have. I've heard these stories before.
From 7th Avenue, from Atlantic City. And I'm not so high class that I can avoid looking at realities. I can't afford to be aloof.
The great thing about Woody Allen films, whether he's in them or not, is that he always casts them well. You know, he's a terrific director, and he casts magnificently, I think, in the films that I've seen of his. This one's terrific. He's got Woody Allen, of course, playing Woody Allen, as he always plays the same character in each film. But that nothing, there's anything wrong with that. Then he's got you've got Alan Alda, who's a terrific actor, who's just so wonderfully self-obsessed in this movie. It's terrific. You have Martin Landau and his storyline, which of course is the basis of this music, this movie, this music, I'm obsessed, this movie, I think that he got a Best Supporting Actor Oscar this year, and he got nominated for this Best Actor, but I think he should have won for this. I think it's a terrific performance. Angelica Houston, who was so wonderfully annoying in this film, she's so annoying. I mean, if you see the film, or if you remember the film, she's, you know, she really grates your nerves, you know, the way she's dressed, her hair, my God, what are you going to do with the woman? But also she's the most sympathetic character in the film. And, of course, Mia Farrow, who plays the love interest of the film.
Yeah, it's Hallie Reed, you cut me off. Okay.
Excuse me, we haven't officially met.
Hi, I'm Hallie Reed, I'm one of the associate producers.
I'm Clifford Stern. Can I ask you the same question that I asked the producer? What do you bother with this guy for? I mean, he's, you know, he's such a pompous bore, and your show does such great profiles.
Well, listen, I'll tell you, just between you and me, I wanted to do Gabriel Garcia Marquez.
That's perfect.
They like to mix it up. They like a little variety. After all, he is an American phenomenon.
Yeah, but so is Acid Rain.
I give this film 9.5 out of 10. On the Dave scale, 9.5 out of 10. Woody Allen's Crimes and Misdemeanors. Why 9.5 out of 10? So many reasons that I can't compress now, but things like Alan Alda's character, the way you can just laugh at him and his self-obsessedness, and that's the light side of the film. And then there's the dark side, as I said before, of Martin Landau's character, the darkness of his character, and the cinematography, his character becomes darker in that. The soundtrack, fabulous soundtrack. You know, even Angelica Houston being such a bitchy little character. What the hell? It's all terrific. I highly recommend it. I thank everyone for having me here on In Between the Sprockets. Also, I'll be touring to your state, town, country, theater very soon in a kid inside. Please watch out. Take care. Drive safely. Who am I talking to here? And thank you for joining us on In Between the Sprockets.
Well, that's about wraps it up for tonight, but next week we'll be back with our regular program. That's more news and views of the movie industry with a bent edge. But before we go tonight, we're going to be screening the short film Wax Me from local filmmaker Kelly Simpson. Kelly's really going places. Her latest film starred Toni Collette, of all people, and it's called This Marching Girl Thing. But we knew her way back when. Wax me. That's an order. Now.
Dear fellow, can I help you?
We hadn't forgotten about you, Mrs. Searle.
I can be so warm and tender. Call me. Don't be afraid, you can call me. Maybe it's late, but just call me. Tell me and I'll be around. When it seems your friends desert
you. Don't worry, darling. Just think of it as a preparation for childbirth.
I'm the one who'll never hurt you. Maybe that's because I love you. Call me. Don't be afraid, you can call me. Maybe it's late, but just call me. Call me and I'll be around. And don't forget me, cause if you let me, I will always stay by you. You gotta try to.
Oh, Camille, there's a call out waiting for you. Okay.
Everyone. Well, you are a strenuous bore. Why don't you come out with us this evening?
Oh, I don't know.
What is there to know?
She might be cute, but she's a brainless slut.
I beg your pardon. You've obviously got brains, because you certainly haven't got any beauty.
The whole place is talking, Camille. You've got to be more careful. More careful about what? You know about what. Look, we've got to work here too, you know. The others won't stand for it.
So, what's happened here then?
Oh, the towels just fell down. I'm rearranging them. Bitch.
Don't you have something you could be doing, Camille?
Joan Rivers called him the gay Seinfeld. He is Bob Smith, America's number one gay comedian, and he's coming to Australia this month for his Growing Up Gay tour. He'll be in Melbourne at the Universal Theatre from September 19 to 23 and Sydney at the Harbourside Brasserie from September 24 to 30. Tickets available through Bass, Ticketek or direct from the venues. And Sprockets has some double passes to give away. Melbourne viewers call between 10 to 10.30 on Tuesday 19th September and Sydney viewers call between the same hours on Friday 22nd of September.